That's our next topic is diffraction. So diffraction is bending of light around an obstacle whose size is comparable to wavelength of light. It is the bending of light around an obstacle whose size is comparable to wavelength of light. So here we consider superposition of waves within a wavefront, within a single wavefront. So here we consider superposition of sin omega t, sin omega t plus delta, sin omega t plus 2 delta, sin omega t plus sin minus 1 delta. So like this we have n different terms. I am considering superposition of n waves with a phase difference of lambda each, and I want to see the resultant direction. Result is, so let's say if I consider amplitude for all as A, I want to see amplitude for resultant wave. A is the total amplitude, capital A. Phi is, capital phi is total phase difference. So I am taking a vector diagram. Let's say if I represent sin omega t like this, the next vector will have phase difference of delta. So I represent it like this, sin omega t plus delta. Here delta is the phase angle between the two vectors. So if we keep on representing this, so like this, I'll have group of n vectors, each with a phase difference of delta. And I want to see the resultant vector. This is the required. To get that, I consider all vectors are on the rim of a circle or on the circumference of a circle of radius r. Assume all vectors are on a circumference of a circle of radius r. So here from first vector to second vector, the phase angle is delta. and this one is 5 from first vector to last vector. So now I want to know the magnitude of this vector. Here it is, the magnitude is A. Here the magnitude is capital A. Here the magnitude of vector is A. Here it is capital A. So now, what shall I do? I have a triangle here. R, R, A. This angle is delta. So if I divide it into 2, this is delta by 2. This is A by 2, A by 2. I want to know the value of R or A. So I need to connect R and A. So which one will connect that? Sine delta by 2 is A by 2 by R. So A is 2R sin delta by 2. R is equal to A by 2 sin delta by 2. Whatever way. And we have to see the next vector also resulted. So how many vectors do we have? N, total n number of vectors. So from here phi is n delta. So for each vector you have a phase difference of delta. Here 2 delta, 3 delta, 4 delta. So by the end of first vector you got a phase difference of delta. 2 delta, 3 delta, 4, 5. So this is the nth vector. So you get n delta. So phi is n delta. And now if I apply the same rule, this is phi by 2. This is R. R. This is capital A. Phi by 2 is A by 2 by R. So from here A is equal to a is equal to a times sine n delta by 2 by sine delta by 2. So here this angle is 90 minus delta by 2. This is 90 minus n delta by 2. So I cannot call this as phi. Resultant phase angle anadi ikkada measure cheyali. Original nunchi entha deviate ayyindani. This is phi. So I want to get that value of phi. This is n delta. That is n delta. So I want to get that value of phi. This is n delta by 2. So what do you have? This is 90 minus delta by 2 and this is 90 minus n delta by 2. So what? So this is 90 minus n delta by 2 and this total angle is 90 minus delta by 2. And we need this difference as phi. So phi is equal to 90 minus delta by 2 minus 90 minus n delta by 2. Omega t plus phi can be written as a sin n delta by 2 by sin delta by 2 sin omega t plus n minus 1 delta. So what do you observe here? The amplitude is also a function of phase now. Amplitude is not constant, it is varying as a function of delta. And phase also depends on delta. So where to see the variations of this function? So if I consider delta to be very very small, I mean I am considering very small value of delta, so that n will be very large. So the given interval, let's say even if it is 10 degrees, I divide it into 10 parts or 100 parts, so that delta will be very small and n will be very large. Then what happens to that? Call this as n delta by 2 as alpha. So then delta by 2 is alpha by n. Right. So in this condition, what happens to this? n is very large and delta by 2 is very small. What happens to this? This is what about sine delta by 2? Will become delta by 2, which is alpha by n. So this total term A sine alpha by n. And sin omega t plus alpha, because n is very large, this n minus 1 is also will be equal to, I mean n minus 1 delta by 2 also will be equal to alpha. So the total term n a sin alpha by alpha sin omega t plus alpha. So you get n times the amplitude. So if all are in the same phase, you will be left with n times amplitude. But there is a phase difference of delta at every level. So you got a term this sin alpha by alpha as a modification for the total amplitude. So what if delta is completely zero? So if all waves mix in a same phase, sum of n such waves will give you a vector of length na. Right? But here there is a phase difference at every level of delta. What happened to the result? The total amplitude Na is manipulated by a factor of sin alpha by alpha. So what if delta is 0? Delta 0 is the demo of Nande? Alpha is also 0. Alpha 0 is the sin alpha by alpha m of Nande? So when alpha approaches 0, sin alpha becomes alpha, that value becomes 1. So we'll have n times a as the resultant amplitude. So because of the phase difference, you have sin alpha by alpha. So if you draw a graph for this sin alpha by alpha, it looks like this. You will have a maxima at 0, which is equal to 1. And sin x becomes 1 for every pi by 2 difference. And at pi value, sin x becomes 0. This is pi, 3 pi by 2, you will get a maxima. So this is 2 pi by 2, 4 pi by 2, 2 pi, you will get a 0, and 5 pi by 2, you will get a maxima. So like that, the distribution goes on. Alpha. Alpha versus sin alpha by alpha. So it will have zero set pi, 2 pi, 3 pi and maxima set. There is no maxima at pi by 2. We will have maxima starting from 3 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2, 7 pi by 2. At 0, its value is 1. So here the graph is between sine alpha by alpha versus alpha. So on x-axis you have alpha. What is alpha? N delta by 2. Right. So the phase difference between any two consecutive waves. So what is that phase difference? How do they differ? Let's say if you draw a graph for sin omega t and sin omega t plus delta. How do they differ? What is the difference between those two? Clear this and so what did we do here? We considered a group of waves with a phase difference sin omega t, sin omega t plus delta plus sin omega t plus 2 delta, so on sin omega t plus n minus 1 delta, n number of waves with a phase difference of delta each. So how do they look like? What is the difference? So draw a graph for sin omega t and sin omega t plus delta. సైనమగటి గ్రాఫ్ ఎట్లా గీస్తారండి? టేబుల్ వేసుకోవాలి. 0 degrees సైన్ 0 0, 90 degrees 180 degrees 0, 270 మైనస్ 1, 360 1. Give it a graph like that. Okay, so omega t plus delta, let's say I consider it as 45 degrees
addition.
Sin omega t plus 45 degrees anukuntanu for the time being. So omega t 0 aithe అంటే
0.7 90 degrees
దగ్గర 1.90 అనుకోండి, డైరెక్ట్ 90 అనుకోండి, ఈవెన్ మోర్ కన్వీనియంట్
సైన్ 90 అంటే 1 ఫస్ట్ 1 అయిపోతుంది.
సో 0 దగ్గర సైన్ ఒమేగా టీ ప్లస్ 90 విల్ బి 1
సైన్ 180
90 డిగ్రీస్ కి టోటల్ 180 వస్తుంది. 180 కి 270 మైనస్ 1, 270 కి 360 0, 360 కి 90 అగైన్ 1. సో యూల్ గెట్ ఏ కొసైన్ వేవ్. అండ్ ఏంటి, ఇఫ్ యూ కంపేర్ బోత్ ఆఫ్ దెమ్ ది గ్రాఫ్ హస్ షిఫ్టెడ్ బ్యాక్వర్డ్స్ by factor of 90 degrees.
And that is the base change,
shifted to zero. If it is plus, shift is backwards. If it is minus, this will be equal. So, ante enti actual ga, this wave train started little late. This is traveling first. So, this wave train is lagging by a phase of 90. So, on a time axis, it is shifting backwards or it started late. So, what are we doing here? We are adding a set of wave trains which have started at different time stamps. One is started, another one. So everyone have a different starting time. We are adding all such wave trains and trying to see the resultant. So because of this phase difference between the wave trains, after superposition, the amplitude, if all of them have same phase, amplitude would have added up and we get double the amplitude. But because of the phase difference, what happened? Amplitude itself is varying. Amplitude is what? The maximum value.
Peak value.
So peak value is varying as a function of phase now. So now it is Na times sin alpha by alpha. So if you draw a graph for amplitude, you should have gotten a straight line. In this case, here it is. This is Na. This is Na times sin alpha by alpha. So here the phase variations can be seen on the time axis directly. So a phase shift of 90 is represented as a shift on the time axis. So here what is happening? The amplitude is varying as a function of phase. Here on x-axis you have alpha or delta phase. So that means the amplitude is varying as a function of time. So initially at 0 time it has maximum amplitude and becomes 0 and becomes maxima again, again 0, again maxima. So as a function of time the amplitude is varying. Okay. So now all these time variations can be mapped onto spatial variations. So I've seen that already. Spatial variations and time variations are interrelated by wave equation. Dou square u by dou t square is equal to v square dou square u by dou t square. So the variations in time domain can be mapped onto variations in space domain. So you'll get similar graph as a function of space also. So at various locations in space, amplitude varies like that. So at the origin, at the center, you have maximum amplitude, and as you go further and further, amplitude reduces. Okay, so that can be seen. We'll see that. So here I'm taking a green laser and taking a wire. Light is falling on the wire. And we see a diffraction pattern like this. The central fringe is maximum. And as we go to higher orders, the intensity is reducing.
just like shown in the graph.
So if we use a green laser, this is the pattern, and this is the gaps between two maxima you observe. And if you use red, this is the pattern. So gap is higher for red. So the gap between maximas is higher for red compared to green. Okay. So this is grating. This has 15,000 lines per inch. 50,000 lines per inch. So it acts as a multiple diffraction elements. So if we see, we'll get a diffraction pattern for red laser. So here the central maxima is bright, and second, third maxima's brightness is getting reduced. And if I use green laser, so this is the pattern. Central maximum, points of the central maximum. So with green laser the separation is lower compared to that of red. So here both the central maximas are overlapping. So if you see, central maximas are overlapping. Green has a lesser bandwidth compared to that of red. Okay. So the governing equation for single diffraction element, single wire or slit, there is a Babinet's rule for diffraction, where diffraction pattern remains same if the obstacle is replaced with transparent material and transparent region is replaced with obstacle. So if I use a single slit, whatever the diffraction pattern you observe will be same as the diffraction pattern you observe with a wire. So if I replace the opaque surface with transparent medium and transparent medium with opaque surface, the diffraction pattern remains the same. So I will get the similar diffraction pattern for wire and as well as for slit. For wire I will get a diffraction pattern like this, and for slit also I will get a diffraction pattern in the same way. So here let's say this distance is capital D and size of this obstacle is small d. Okay. So then n lambda is d sine theta. So if the separation between consecutive maximas is x, then sine theta is dx by square root of x square plus d square. So that is n lambda. So this is the location of maximus. Maybe depending on n, this may be second maxima, third maxima, like that. It will go on. Okay. And for grating, grating has a number of lines. Like say in the grating that we have used, it has 15,000 lines per inch. We can use the same formula. N lambda is d sine theta. D is the separation between the grating elements. Okay. So what is that? We have 15,000 lines per inch. So width of each element is? In 1 inch we have 15,000 lines. Width of each line. You have to take the distance 1 inch by 15,000. This width of each element. So otherwise 2.54 centimeters by 15,000 centimeters is width of each diffraction element. So then we have got diffraction width like some 30 centimeters or 50 centimeters. Seen that, right? So make a small calculation. Suppose this distance is around 1 meter. Capital D is 1 meter. Okay, so this distance is 1 meter. Width of each element is 1 meter means 100 centimeters. Width of each element is 2.54 by 15,000 centimeters. Then lambda for green it is 534 nanometers, for red it is 630 nanometers. D is 2.54 by 15,000 centimeters. Capital D, 100 centimeters. So n lambda is d sine theta. So you have to get the value of x.
Otherwise, x is also known, right, already.
So compare with the wavelength. Get the value of lambda and check whether you get that 630 or those numbers. Lambda is d sin theta. D is what? 2.54. By 15,000 into sine theta. Sine theta x is 50 centimeters by 100 square plus 50 square. It's a rough calculation. I mean,
we did not measure the lens actually.
So this value comes out to be around 757 nanometers or 7.57 into 10 power minus 5 centimeters. Okay. So that is the rough estimation for the wavelength of light we have used. So here what is happening actually, we are adding up a group of waves which have a different starting times, and when you add all of them, what is happening? There is an intensity distribution in space. So I am taking a slit, let's say, and I am taking a light source which is emitting some wavefront, and by the time it reaches the other end on the screen, you have maximum intensity here and a zero point, another lower intensity, even lower intensity. So this is how the intensity pattern is distributed on the screen. So actual expected is a uniform distribution, but because of the phase differences, there is a change in the amplitude also, amplitude or intensity. So what is happening? The wavefront, the coming in this direction, is now turning into this direction. Are the light rays coming straight away towards the screen, or now turning and giving some other maxima, secondary maxima, tertiary maxima, like that. So this bending of light around an obstacle is called diffraction, right? So the conclusion of the story is, if there is a shift in time, there will be a shift in spatial orientation also. So if you are mixing two or three waves with different starting times, is equivalent to shifting the orientation of the wave in the space. So that is what happened. Actually, you are mixing waves with different starting times. The result is a shift in the orientation of the wave in the space. The variation in a time domain is reflecting as a variation in space domain. So this is the reason why every point on the wavefront acts as a source of secondary wavelets. So we have started with a point source. The wavefront is generated like that. Okay, so that means there are waves traveling in this direction, starting from the source, like this, right? So what is happening now? I'm taking another point on this wavefront, means at this point, let's say. So here actually it has contribution from only this wave. So it should generate a progressive wave in this direction only. I mean, our general intuition says the wave continues in this direction only. But what is happening? We are getting entire wavefront. So from this point, again all waves are generated. So if I take interference pattern, we are taking two slits. So up to here, one wavefront is coming, and from this point, again two wavefronts are generated. So what is happening? Each point on the wavefront acts as a source of secondary wavelets. This is because a time varying wavelets mix up together to generate a spatially varying wavelets. So if you have a bunch of waves with the time lag coming in this direction, they can generate all spatially oriented waves. from that point. So that is the reason why each point on the wavefront acts as a source of secondary wavelengths. And the superposition of all those secondary wavelets is now leading to diffraction. Okay. So this D is called the width of diffraction element. And it is obtained by this total width by number of lines. So here the diffraction angle is proportional to the wavelength of light used. Okay, whereas in the case of a prism, diffraction angle is inversely proportional to, or the refractive index is inversely proportional to lambda square. So more the wavelength, more is the less is the refractive index. So what we see here is red deviates less compared to green or blue. Whereas in this case this angle is proportional to lambda. So here more the wavelength, more is the angle of diffraction. So you see blue first, then green, then red. So from the center, from the original direction, blue deviates less than red. So first blue will appear, then green, then red. Whereas in the case of prism, from the original direction, first red appears, then green, and then. This is the basic difference between dispersion and diffraction. So next one, bending of light around an obstacle. So I'm seeing some light here in this room. Because of the light coming from the sun, I'm not directly seeing the sun, but I'm able to see the light from the sun. I mean, can it be considered as diffraction? Is it diffraction? So diffraction is bending of light around an obstacle. But the primary condition is the size of the object must be comparable to wavelength of light. So this diffraction angle so sine theta is what? N lambda by T. Sin theta value varies from 0 to 1. So wavelength and size of the obstacle must be comparable. The ratio should be between 0 and 1. So size of the obstacle must be comparable to wavelength of light used. Otherwise you cannot see diffraction. So I'm seeing sunlight through this window is because of scattering of light on the air molecules. It's not due to diffraction. So a size of the obstacle cannot be the size of this window. It should be comparable to wavelength of light. Okay. So coming to one important problem on grating is this. And the grating formula is this, n lambda is d sin theta, where d is the width of the grating element. So now we need to find out the number of orders, maximum number of orders. So for annuality to be maximum, we have to consider the maximum value of sine theta here. So n maximum lambda is d. It is sine 90. So n maximum is d by lambda. Now suppose if the width of the grating element is around 9000 angstroms and the wavelength of light used is 4000 angstroms. Now what is this? It is 2.25. So the maximum number of orders observed is, you have to consider the integer part of it, even if it is 2.9 you have to write 2. The maximum number of orders observed is 2. So if I take a diffraction element of size 9000 angstroms, obstacle size 9000 angstroms and wavelength of light used is 4000 angstroms, then we can see a maximum of 2 orders. So this is 0, first order, second order. So beyond that you can't see. So this is the maximum number of orders that can be observed in a grating.